Welcome, welcome. Welcome to Science Sci-Fi, connecting the public to science and technology. And welcome to my basement. My name is Ronis Friedman. I am a science fiction writer and an IT professional. Today, we are going to talk about future ideologies, a framework on how future ideologies or future philosophy may look like. I don't have an exact solution, unlike previous presentation, on what it is and how it should be look like. But I'm going to do a review about past ideologies, what we currently have in the world, and some way that the world may change in the future, and why do we need a new ideology, and some thought about how those ideologies can look like. And of course, if you have any suggestion or you want to engage me, invite me to a discussion panel on this topic, or have some ideas on how future ideologies, will be an open discussion. Feel free to engage and or comment or connect. So let's start and dive. The future of ideologies. I'll start with a quote. The only constant in life is chance. Heraclitus. So what on the agenda today? We're going to talk about past ideologies. We start with the Middle Ages and Renaissance, the feudalism, absolute monarchy. Then we move to the humanist ideologies that started in the 18th century with the Age of Enlightenment, with liberalism, democracy, capitalism, the 19th century ideology of socialism and communism, 20th century ideology, World War II, when was the big clash between all the modern ideologies, social democracy, the challenges that you are facing right now in the 21st, in the beginning of the 21st century, and some thought about the framework for a future discussion and future ideologies. Reference and contact information will be provided at the end. So stay tuned. Past ideologies. In the Middle Ages and the Renaissance, most of the ideologies were based on religion and monarchy. Of course, there were some democracy in ancient, in classical time, in ancient Greeks. Vikings were kind of elected leader. But generally speaking, all society were based on religion. God or gods governed the world. Priests were the ones who knew how to interpret the gods and the will of the gods. And we had kings or sultans or emperors that ruled vast amount of territory. So the big forces were religion and empire, or big countries that were controlled by kings. It could be distributed monarchy, which is more similar to feudalism. There were different lords, and the lords had the lords above them, and eventually there was a king that was the head of the state, or the head of the empire. Or it could be something like Louis the 14th, which has an absolute monarchy, so he controlled everything. But with the Age of the Enlightenment, this has changed. It started with a few philosophers that came to the idea of individualism and money and capitalism, and the idea that human have human rights and liberty. So we had the American Revolution in 1776, followed by the French Revolution, and liberalism or liberal humanism become a new force that was competing with monarchy or absolute monarchy power of the time that were mostly Europe, France, Britain, Holland, the Spanish Empire. There were also some big empire in East Asia, China, and the Mughal Empire in India. But this new ideology was gaining power. It allowed people, by gaining more freedom, they were able to innovate more and become more economically successful. And this slowly took over most of the monarchies in Western Europe and in North America, the Western world. So that ideology included democracy, capitalism, free market, freedom of religion, freedom of speech, freedom of the press. Of course, that ideology it took nearly 100 years on it, got off slavery, but that's beside the point. Let's continue. Next ideology come was invented by thinker, not philosophers like in the 18th century, but thinker like Karl Marx or Engels, who decide to come up with a solution to different problems that came as part of the Industrial Revolution. So the Industrial Revolution changed society. Instead of most people working agriculture to providing food, people flow to the city and they become workers who work in factories. And they work for terrible condition, like 14 hours a day, 7 days a week. They didn't get a lot of money. The people who own the factory get most of the money. And this was a problem. And those thinkers tried to come up with a new engineered society and engineered ideology in order to solve this problem. So the idea that they came about was socialism. Later, some part of socialism became communism. The idea there is that society is the center, not the individual, not free market. It should be a control market, a planned market by benevolent people at the top. They know what is best and they will organize it in such a way that the factories will not be controlled by the capitalist, but instead they will be owned by society. And also regulation will be dictated by that government in order to benefit the people, benefit the proletariat, benefit the masses, the poor people, the workers, rather than the industrialized or the capitalist. So this was the main idea, shift the power to the worker. And then it didn't catch up in the West, but in Russia, the Russian Revolution took place and it took it by storm and they changed the whole society. There were a lot of problems with this system, but some good things. We'll talk about that in later. The third ideology that compete for dominance in the 20th century was fascism or Nazism. Sometimes people call it evolutionary humanism. The center of this ideology of fascism is the nation, and in the case of Nazism, the race. The nation or the race were above everything else. Their goal was to improve humanity by removing inferior races. I'm saying inferior in quote because they imagined them to be inferior. They also based their ideology on eugenics, and it was inspired by some pseudoscience that was inspired by natural selection or social Darwinism. They took what they saw in nature, that how natural selection took place, that the big, stronger animal ate the weaker animal, and then tried to convert this to a philosophy. And the idea there is that the strong races will be dominated and replace the weak races, and this is how humanity is going to improve in the future. And then came the big shebang, the big conflict of the 20th century, World War II. So the first part of World War II that started in 1937 in Eastern Asia and in 1939 in Europe, it was a bit mixture. Some groups were, some countries and empires were fighting each other, but it was become apparent that once Germany invaded the Soviet Union in 1941, that we have a struggle between democracy and communism and socialism on one side, and on the other side was fascism. Many argue that the Empire of Japan was also a form of fascism. So by 1945, the war ended and fascism was completely crushed. That's including Germany, Italy, Japan, and all the other Axis allies. And the remaining dominant ideology were communism and democracy. Post-war, we had the Cold War. The world was divided into two blocks. The part was dominated by communism or socialism. It was primarily the Soviet Union that took over Eastern and part of Central Europe. China was also become fully communist. Other countries were either socialist or under the influence of the communist bloc. And on the other side, we had the democracy or capitalist states, including the US, the Western Europe countries, and they dominated the Western hemispheres, Western Europe, and some part of the Middle East, Australia, and Africa was divided between the two blocks. We had in this area where the fascinating things going on, we had the space race. It was the first time that humans were able to get to the moon. We had nuclear arsenal that put the world at the brink of total annihilation, because a nuclear war would have destroyed and potentially even caused our extinction. But on the other hand, the nuclear, the MAD principle, mutual assurance destruction, the nuclear arsenal, because it was so devastating and such a high potential to destroy everything, that kept the peace, or kind of a relative peace. So since the end of World War II, the number of war in the world were not completely eliminated, but they were vastly reduced. We have a lot, much fewer wars. And in 1991, the Soviet Union collapsed. So the general consensus was the democracy won, communism was completely defeated, and there is only one ideology left. But that's not the end of the story. Right now, most of the world is operate not by pure capitalism or pure communism, but some kind of hybrid. We have a social democracy that's still keeping capitalism in place for as the main economic system, still have democracy, but they adopted some elements from socialism in order to make a better society. So people can have democracy. It's not a totalitarian state, Soviet style. The people can vote and replace the government and change the balance a little bit more towards socialism, a little bit more towards capitalism, based on how people feel and want to elect. Private ownership is still possible. People can own properties. People can own corporation, private corporation, or public corporation that not owned by society, but owned by stakeholders or stockholders. But we have the part of socialism that is kept, including social safety net. We have social security. If somebody loses his job, he can get something from the government. Elderly, old people get some benefits from the government. We have most democratic countries have universal health care or some kind of help to people who don't have the means to pay for private insurance. We have free education for at least for children. Some countries have even universities are free. We have regulated business, which is basically socialism, not extreme socialism, but mild socialism. Unions are permitted. This is where most of the world is right now. We have social democracy, that is capitalism mixed with some socialism to various degrees. China is a different story. I don't really know how to pinpoint the exact ideology. They kept the communist branding, but they have some capitalism in place, but it's still a totalitarian state. It is what it is. So, what are the current issues that we are facing right now? First issues is pessimism and nihilism over topics like overpopulation, poverty, climate change. People, if you can see, are very upset, very angry. Most people I speak with don't think the future is bright. They think we are facing an apocalypse, everything is bad, they are the victims, nothing much can be done. Some people are optimistic, but they are not the majority, regrettably. Other issue we have is climate change. So it's not just a perception of climate change. Climate change is a real thing that happened. So the picture here is from Interstellar, the dust storms that cover almost the entire world and impact agriculture. We are not there yet, but there are some areas that have more rain than usual that could cause a problem, flooding. We have maybe more hurricanes. And if the trend will continue, then we are going to face either disruption like sea level rising, and the agriculture is going to change the way it is now, and it could be a major catastrophe to the planet. So this is a real issue. that is addressed to some degrees by different political systems. And we have big political divide right now in the world. We have populism, like make America great again, left versus right. It is intensified. This political divide that we have right now, especially in the West, is intensified by social media that run algorithms that try to seek attention, and they do the engagement seeking by making people angry. So if somebody writes something, they try to put it on the feed of people who have the opposite opinion. And so there will be some argument and discussion. People are very angry. That's destroys society, but it makes the social media outlet money. So that's what we have right now, and it is a problem. Other issue we face is population collapse. Right now, most countries have very few kids compared to in the past. We used to have pyramids, a lot of young people, few older people, and very few elderly. Right now, some countries is like vertical or even upside down pyramid that we have, you know, like China with the one child policy. So every two couples have only one child. Also, a lot of Western countries, where I live in Canada, it's only 1.41 kids per family, and replacement level is 2.1. So we have a fewer children, and each generation is smaller than the previous one. It caused a lot of problem, one that population can eventually shrink. But in the near future, what it means that the population is aging. We have more older people and fewer young people that can support them. And this is a problem. It could cause an economic problem. It changed. This is something that never happened in history or rarely happened in history. Another problem we have in today's society is that we have more and more and more regulation in place. The way politicians work, they see something happen or some idea that flow around the public, and they decide, oh, let's fix that. So they add another regulation, and then they add another regulation. So we have more and more regulation put in place, and not as many regulations that they came out of the system. So we have a political system or taxation system that only become more and more complex as time passes. I'm not saying that regulation is a bad thing. Regulation is a good thing. It could prevent bad players, and there are some reasons why they're put in place. But I do say that some of the regulations are probably outdated, and they should be revoked, and we shouldn't have too many regulations that just might make life too complex and make innovation or anything you try to do, you won't be able to do just because we have too many regulations and too many stakeholders that come into place. Now we got into the interesting stuff. Other things that are going to disrupt the future, disruptive technologies. The most prominent disruptive technology that I believe is coming into place is AI or AI and robotics. Machines that are very soon going to be smarter than us. And this is going to replace us, not replace physically, but replace our job. So this is going to be a lot of economical challenges. Of course, the productivity will go up significantly, and we are going to see AI coming into place this year, next year, at an exponential rate. Everybody know now about AI art. AI can win all game. Recently, it was Go, AlphaFold. It could going to revolutionize industry, healthcare, self-driving cars, almost. All industry are going to change significantly to it AI. And also there is a factor that AI will be smarter than us. So can we control something smarter than us? And the answer is probably no. Other issue that is going to happen due to disruptive technology is genetic engineering and transhumanism, radical life extension. So people are going to live long. So this means that we're going to have dictator or politician that stay in office for 50 years, 100 years, 200 years. It may cause stagnation. Also, capitalism, the system we have right now, doesn't know how to handle it. Like people who have money are going to modify themselves, modify their kids, that they will become healthier, smarter, have different ability. We may even divert into more than one species. and some of them are going to be, that's like the wet dream of the Nazis, they're going to be a superior humans. And if you let capitalism decide who is going to be superior and who is not, that's probably not the best system that we want for the future. Other issue is surveillance states, you know, or even corporation, social media companies. The states are going to know a lot of things about us and are going to have a lot of control over us and over the individual. And this could be a problem. Like, do we want to be subject to the whims of those who are in power and they will control every aspect of our life? They can control our money, they can disable it, enable it, tell us exactly how to behave. And if we don't do that, then we are going to suffer. This is a problem that we want to think about that. And we have space colonization and space exploration that is revolutionized the way the human species. Like, we are going to very soon be able to go to other planets, other celestial body, have access to the nearly infinite resource of space. And this, I don't know if it's going to have a Star Trek future, but this is something that is going to significantly change human history and human and the trajectory of our civilization. So let's talk a little bit about the framework that I told you I don't have the idea of what it should look like, but some points to think about. A lot of philosophers that I've been hearing about discussing about future ideology saying that our goal should be happiness. I think happiness is a very important goal, but probably not the top goal. And I have two issues with putting happiness above everything else. First, it could cause a dystopian society, like a utilitarian state, not utilitarian, totalitarian state that control the entire world. And they give some kind of drugs, like in the Brave New World in Huxley book and TV series, that people will be given some drugs and they will be very happy, but they will be under control of some elite. This is probably not something that we want. And another issue is the AI that we spoke earlier. Suppose we tell the AI to do everything it can to eliminate suffering. And that AI decides that if it kills all the people, there will be no suffering. We don't want this solution. Trust me. So that's why I propose that survival should take precedence over happiness. Also, we want an ideology that will address all the issues that I listed earlier. I'm not going to repeat them now. Also, nature tells us that diversity is the key to survive, natural selection. If we have a changing world and we have only one world government that control everyone with a totalitarian 1984 style or Brave New World, which is people are happier, but still one totalitarian state that has one head of state and he decide and know everything that is good for everyone. He may be right in most cases, but as the world change, it is a very, very risky strategy that putting all your eggs in one bet. And nature showed us that typically if we have diversity or different animal, different groups that are a little bit behave a little bit differently and some catastrophe happens, some will survive, some will not. And we don't want to have one civilization that depend that it's a pyramid top down that control everything. And if this one collapse, then it's done. We are done. It's better to have multiple civilization, and if one of them collapse, we still have all the rest. It's a better survival strategy. What other things? So let's do a recap and then add a little more parameters. First one, we want to increase the survival rate of our species, of humans. And we also make people thrive, because thriving means better survival chances. We want to help the survival of other life form, like all the plants and animal, fungus, like all the animal, all the kingdoms, not not maybe not all life forms in total, but we want to help life survive, especially if something bad happened on Earth. We want to have life spread throughout the solar system and maybe later to the universe, and also make action right here on Earth to prevent climate change or other catastrophe, nuclear war. So not just us are going to survive, but other life forms as well, other animals and plants, etc., etc. And we want to increase happiness. Earlier I said that we don't want happiness to be top priority, but we definitely want to be happy and give it a high priority. But still want to avoid the extreme cases where happiness increase the chances of extinction. And we want mechanism to avoid too much regulation that just become more and more and more complex. We want some kind of mechanism that will allow us to put new regulations, but also take regulations that are outdated out. We want to have an optimistic view of the future. Not glorify the past, like make America great again. We want to make the future even greater than whatever it was in the past. We don't want to go to the Middle Ages, to wars, world wars, or local wars, and famine, and all the problems that we had in the past, diseases. We want to make decisions based on information, on data, not based on some holy texture that not related to the, or some ideology that not related to the real world. We want to solve problems through science and research and development, not by shrinking the population or try to go to the past. And we probably want to avoid a super totalitarian states, either had by a human or by an artificial intelligence, though it could function for some time in a more efficient way. And we want to, and assuming we are not to have a one totalitarian global state, we want to have a mechanism to encourage a win-win collaboration between the different entities, the different states, that will benefit everyone, and also in order to address global issues such as climate change, etc. So what's next? Do what Marx and Engels did in the 19th century. They saw the problem within the Industrial Revolution, and they tried to come with the solution. The solution was, of course, eventually failed when taken to the extreme. But we try to avoid our mistakes. So that's why I'm trying to throw in some ideology right now. I want to do some more thinking about that. I also want other people to think about that, and maybe we can collaborate and come up with a good idea that will allow us to have an ideology or a number of ideology that will improve the human condition and improve our chances of survival and improve happiness and make us flourish. If you want to contact me, I'll leave the contact information at the bottom. You can leave a comment on YouTube. And if you want to do some kind of discussion panel, I'll be happy to host it or join some other YouTubers on their panel. Or if you want to invite me for a speaking opportunity, we can do that. My contact information, this is my Twitter handle, and I will leave below how to contact me on other platforms. Well, thank you very much, and I hope to see you in the next video, and I hope you think about some ideas on how to improve the human condition, what kind of ideology you want to see in the future. Let me know what you think and leave your comments below. Thank you, and see you next time.